Presenting the topic of optimization of antimicrobial dosing, and my moderator is Dr. Sudhindra sir. Coming to introduction, antimicrobials agents are some of the most widely and often injudiciously used therapeutic drugs worldwide. Obtaining an accurate diagnosis of infection, understanding difference between empirical and definitive therapy is important. And also identifying opportunities to switch to narrow spectrum is also important. Cost-effective oral agents for the shortest duration necessary, pharmacodynamics and efficacy at the site of infection, and the last point is antimicrobial stewardship, that is to know when to consult infectious disease specialist for guidance. Selecting and initiating an antibiotic regimen. Obtaining an accurate infectious diagnosis. The diagnosis is often reached by determining the site of infection, defining the host, example immunocompromised, diabetic, advanced age, and establishing a microbiological diagnosis. And it is critical to isolate the specific pathogen, especially for situations that are likely to require prolonged therapy like infective endocarditis, septic arthritis, and meningitis. Clinicians should also ensure that the diagnostic specimens are properly obtained and submitted to the microbiology laboratory before initiation of antimicrobial therapy. That is, before initiating antimicrobial therapy, we should submit the microbiological specimen to the laboratory. Infectious disease diagnosis also rely on a detailed exposure history, and the microbiological diagnosis is based on data like bacterial culture, fungal culture, serology, and most likely etiology can be inferred from the clinical presentation. For example, in conditions like cellulitis, the most frequent organism associated with this streptococci or staphylococci, and antibacterial treatment can be administered in the absence of a positive culture. And a community-associated pneumonia can also be treated empirically with a macrolide or a fluoroquinolone antibiotic without specific diagnostic testing. And non-infectious conditions should also be considered in the differential diagnosis for infections, especially when the diagnosis is not clear cut. Next is timing of initiation of antimicrobial therapy. The timing of initial therapy should be guided by the depending on the urgency of the situation. For example, in conditions like septic shock, febrile neutropenia, bacterial meningitis, the empirical therapy should be started immediately after or concurrently with the collection of diagnostic specimen. And in conditions like subacute bacterial endocarditis, vertebral osteomyelitis, discitis, in this condition, antimicrobial therapy can be delayed until appropriate samples have been collected. Premature initiation of antimicrobial therapy can cause suppressing of the bacterial growth, and it can preclude the opportunities to establish the diagnosis. Coming to empiric versus definite antimicrobial therapy, it will take approximately 2 to 3 days for the microbiological results. Therefore, initial therapy is often empiric and guided by the clinical presentation. Broad spectrum antimicrobial agents or combination as initial empiric therapy can be used to cover multiple possible pathogens commonly associated with specific clinical syndrome. For example, a healthy young adult with a suspected bacterial meningitis, most likely pathogens would be Streptococcus pneumonia and Neisseria meningitis. Therefore, combination of third generation cephalosporin and vancomycin would be recommended as an empirical therapy for that. And hospital acquired infections are frequently related to the presence of invasive devices and procedures like catheter related bloodstream infection, catheter associated urinary tract infection, and ventilator associated pneumonia. So we have already discussed what is empiric therapy and definitive therapy. In case of empiric therapy, the infecting organism is not yet identified, that is broad spectrum. And in case of definite therapy, the infecting organism is identified, that is narrow spectrum, that is specific therapy. They are commonly caused by drug-resistant organisms, MRSA, Pseudomonas, etc. In selecting empiric antimicrobial therapy for such infections, clinicians should consider the following. First one, the site of infection and the organism most likely to be colonizing that site. Example, intravascular catheter associated bacteremia, staphylococci present on skin. Prior knowledge of bacteria should be known to colonize a given patient. For example, a screening nasal swab currently conducted routinely by many hospitals before admitting patients to ICU may indicate that the patient is colonized with MRSA. Next is local resistant patterns or antibiograms that are available for important pathogens at hospitals. Once antimicrobial susceptibility data are available, attempts should be made to narrow the antibiotic spectrum. This can reduce the cost, toxicity, and even prevent the emergence of antimicrobial resistance in the community. And antimicrobial agents with a narrow spectrum should be directed at the most likely pathogens for the duration of therapy for infections such as community-associated pneumonia or cellulitis. Next is coming to interpretation of antimicrobial susceptibility testing. When a pathogenic organism is identified in clinical cultures, next step is microbiological laboratories antimicrobial susceptibility testing. It measures the ability of a specific organism to grow in the presence of a particular drug in vitro and is performed using guidelines established by Clinical and Laboratory Standards Institute. Data are reported in the form of minimum inhibitory concentration. It is the lowest concentration of an antibiotic that inhibits visible growth of a microorganism. It is interpreted by the laboratory as susceptible, resistant, or intermediate. MICs of different agents for a particular organism are not directly comparable. For example, MIC of 1 susceptible for ciprofloxacin and 2 susceptible for ceftriaxone against E. coli do not imply that ciprofloxacin is twice as active as ceftriaxone. Instead, it indicates that concentrations achieved by giving recommended doses of both drugs are likely to be active against the organism. And it is important for the clinicians and laboratory personnel to be aware of the site of infection. The site of infection is also important. For example, in the case of Staph aureus infection, if it is reported as susceptible to cefazolin in vitro, however, if particular isolate was obtained from CSF, it would not be an optimal therapeutic choice because it does not achieve therapeutic concentration in the CSF. A low MIC indicates that the antimicrobial will be most likely be effective and is therefore appropriate choice for the treatment. Instead, a high MIC indicates that it is not appropriate. Based on MIC value, the dosing may be adjusted as regular dosing, higher dose, and maximum dose. Regular dose if the MIC corresponds to susceptible profile, higher dose if MIC falls in the known wild population range but still in the susceptible range, maximum dose if MIC is in the susceptible but borderline or intermediate. These are some of the antibiotic susceptibility tests, like three methods mainly: diffusion, dilution, and both. Diffusion method, Kirby-Bauer method, Stokes method, dilution methods, tube dilution, agar dilution, etc., and e-test. Coming to bactericidal versus bacteriostatic therapy, a commonly used distinction among antibacterial agents is that of bactericidal and bacteriostatic. Bactericidal agents causes death and disruption of the bacterial cell. Example, cell wall beta-lactams, cell membrane, the daptomycin, bacterial DNA, the fluoroquinolones. This acts on these agents. And bacteriostatic agents inhibit the bacterial replication but does not kill the organism. Examples like sulfonamides, tetracyclines, etc. And bactericidal agents are preferred in case of serious infections like infective endocarditis and meningitis because to achieve a rapid cure. These are some of the mnemonics. For bactericidal antibiotics, BANG, QRIP, beta-lactams, aminoglycosides, nitroimidazoles, glycopeptides, quinolones, rifampicins, polymyxin. Next is bacteriostatic antibiotics, macrolides, sulfonamides, chloramphenicol, oxazolidinones, lincosamides, tetracyclines, etc. Next, coming to use of antimicrobial combinations. That is, although single agent antimicrobial therapy is generally preferred, a combination of two or more antimicrobial agents is recommended in future scenarios, like where agents exhibit synergistic activity against a particular microorganism. For example, treatment of endocarditis caused by Enterococcus species with a combination of penicillin and gentamicin can be taken as an example. Penicillin alone is only bacteriostatic, and gentamicin alone has no significant activity. Therefore, if the addition of gentamicin to penicillin, it can be shown to be bactericidal. It has been shown. Next, when critically ill patients require empiric therapy before microbiological etiology and/or antimicrobial susceptibility can be determined. Antibiotic combinations are used in empiric therapy for health failure associated infection that are usually frequently caused by bacteria resistant to multiple antibiotics. And combination therapy used in setting to ensure that at least one of the administered antimicrobial will be effective against the organism. For example, in case of hospital acquired hospitalized one patient who is admitted in the hospital for several weeks. When he develops septic shock, the blood culture report to be gram-negative bacilli. In this case, the appropriate antibiotic initial therapy with two agents will be effective against this gram-negative bacilli. And to extend the antimicrobial spectrum beyond that achieved by the use of a single agent for treatment of polymicrobial infection. So, for example, in case of intra-abdominal infections, usually will be caused by multiple organisms. In these conditions, this antimicrobial spectrum can be used. And antimicrobial combinations such as third generation cephalosporin or a fluoroquinolone plus metronidazole can be used. And it can be more cost effective than a single agent. Next is to prevent the emergence of resistance. The emergence of resistant mutants in a bacterial population is generally the result of selective pressure from antimicrobial therapy. Chance of mutant strain being resistant to both antimicrobial agents is much lower than the chance of it being resistant to one of them. Therefore, combination therapy is better. And also, combination therapy is used as a standard for treatment of infections such as tuberculosis and HIV. And it can prevent the emergence of resistant mutant population. Next is host factors to be considered in the selection of antimicrobial agents. We want to consider the renal and hepatic function. We know that the kidney and the liver are the primary organs responsible for the elimination of drugs from the body. And therefore, it is important to determine how well they are functioning during antimicrobial administration. In most cases, dose reduction might be needed to prevent accumulation and toxicity in these patients with reduced renal or hepatic function. Sometimes dose might need to be increased to avoid underdosing in young healthy individuals. And it can be due to concomitant use of drugs such as rifampicin or phenytoin. Age. Patients at both extremes of age, the drugs should be handled extremely with caution. Pediatric drug dosing is guided by weight. In geriatric patients, the serum creatinine level should be checked. Creatinine also should be checked by factoring in age and weight for these patients. Genetic variations. Genetic susceptibility to the adverse effects of antimicrobial agents has been demonstrated for several antimicrobial agents. It is occasionally significant enough to warrant testing for such variability before administration of certain drugs. Example. Antiretroviral abacavir, which has become a part of standard treatment for HIV infection. It is potentially a fatal hypersensitive reaction, especially in patients who have HLA-B5701, and current HIV treatment guidelines recommend that routine screening is necessary for this genetic susceptibility. Next, coming to pregnancy and lactation. In case of mother, there is increase in plasma volume and the renal blood flow, especially by the third trimester, and can result in more rapid clearance and lower serum levels of pharmaceutical agent. However, higher antimicrobial doses are not routinely recommended in the third trimester. Some experts recommend an increased dose of several protease inhibitors for the management of HIV infection pregnancy. And in case of developing fetus, many antimicrobial agents can be toxic. And human studies on the safety of many antimicrobial agents in pregnancy and lactation are limited. Therefore, antimicrobial agents should be prescribed with caution. History of allergy or intolerance. A history of antimicrobial allergy or intolerance should be routinely obtained in the evaluation and management of infection. And a history of recent antimicrobial use should also be considered, because history of exposure to antimicrobial agents in the recent past can also help in the selection of antimicrobial therapy. The causative agent or the causative microorganism for the current episode of infection should have been emerged under the selective pressure of a recently used antimicrobial agent. Therefore, it is likely to be resistant to that drug, and an alternative drug can be used. Next, coming to oral versus intravenous therapy. Mild to moderate infections can be treated with oral antimicrobial agents, whereas patients initially treated with parenteral therapy can be safely switched to oral antibiotics when they become clinically stable. And in case of when using oral therapy for invasive infection, they should select an agent that has excellent absorption as well as bioavailability. And example of antibiotics with excellent bioavailability are fluoroquinolones, linezolid, metronidazole, etc. For more serious infections like infective endocarditis, meningitis, etc., switching to oral therapy is generally not recommended. Next, coming to pharmacodynamic characteristics. Pharmacodynamic properties of antimicrobial agents is important in establishing a dosing regimen. It depends on the concept of time-dependent versus concentration-dependent killing. Drugs that exhibit time-dependent activity have relatively slow bactericidal action. Therefore, it is important that the serum concentration exceeds the MIC for the duration of the dosing interval, either through continuous infusion or frequent dosing. And the drugs that exhibit concentration-dependent killing have enhanced bactericidal activity as the serum concentration is increased. With these agents, peak serum concentration and not the frequency of the dosing interval is more closely associated with the efficacy. Next, coming to the efficacy at the site of infection. The efficacy of antimicrobial agents also depends on their capacity to achieve a concentration equal to or greater than MIC at the site of infection and modification of activity at certain sites. Antimicrobial concentrations attained at some sites like ocular fluid, CSF, abscess activity, prostate, and bone are often much lower than the serum level. Example, the first generation and the second generation cephalosporins and macrolides do not cross the blood-brain barrier and are not recommended for CNS infections. And the fluoroquinolones achieve high concentration in the prostate and are preferred oral agents for the treatment of prostatitis. Daptomycin is an excellent antibactericidal agent but not useful in the treatment of pneumonia because it is inactivated by the lung surfactant. Many antibiotics are less active in the low oxygen, low pH, and high protein environment of the abscesses. Agents in the same class can differ from one another. And like levofloxacin and ciprofloxacin are excellent choices for UTIs caused by susceptible bacteria. Moxifloxacin that doesn't achieve significant urinary concentration because of its low renal excretion and is therefore not suitable for the treatment of UTI. Instead, levofloxacin and ciprofloxacin are excellent treatment. Also, the presence of foreign bodies at the site of infection will also affect the antimicrobial activity. Coming to therapeutic drug monitoring, that is, monitoring serum concentration for drugs is most useful for medication that is having narrow therapeutic index, that is, ratio of toxic to the therapeutic dose. Most antimicrobials have a wide therapeutic index, allowing standard doses to be used with predictable modifications on the basis of age, weight, renal, and hepatic function. Certain antimicrobial agents require monitoring of serum levels because the therapeutic window is narrow. This could be primarily due to toxicity at high levels, example aminoglycosides, or therapeutic failure at low drug levels, example vancomycin. In some cases, the use of therapeutic drug monitoring is supported by its beneficial effect on clinical outcomes. Example, voriconazole in the treatment of invasive fungal infections. Adverse effect. Allergic or hypersensitive reaction can be either immediate or delayed. 79% of antibiotic-associated adverse events were classified as allergic reactions. And a negative skin test can reliably exclude the possibility of developing and IgE mediated reaction and help optimize antibiotic use. If an ongoing reaction is attributed to an antimicrobial drug allergy, it requires discontinuation of the offending agent. And if the offending agent is the only or the highly preferred agent, desensitization can be used, which involves administration of drug in a progressively increasing doses given by the mouth. Non-allergic drug toxicity is usually associated with higher doses and or prolonged use of antibiotics. It is seen especially in patients with poor kidney or liver function. Example, nephrotoxin with aminoglycoside, with metronidazole causing peripheral neuropathy, etc. Drug doses should be adjusted in response to changes in creatinine level to avoid toxicity and attain optimal serum concentration. Many antimicrobial agents interact with other drugs to increase or decrease their serum levels and effects. This is by their action on cytochrome P450 and same system. Next is cost considerations in antibiotic selection and antimicrobial stewardship. The cost of an antimicrobial agent is dependent on many factors like prolonged hospitalization, administration cost, clinical efficacy, etc. One strategy that can significantly reduce the cost is switch from intravenous to oral therapy. And oral therapy is generally less expensive compared to intravenous. Even if the purchase price of an oral equivalent is greater than the parenteral equivalent, the reduction in the hospital stay can result in significant cost saving. For example, oral linezolid is better than intravenous vancomycin for the treatment of complicated skin and soft tissue infections caused by MRS. Cost considerations in the selection and discontinuation of appropriate antimicrobial therapy in acute care hospitals are part of broader activity that is termed as antimicrobial stewardship program. The main aims of these antimicrobial stewardship programs are optimizing antimicrobial selection, dosing, route and duration of therapy, preventing the emergence of resistance, adverse drug events and the cost. These programs are usually coordinated by a team of infectious disease physician, pharmacist, and are often computer-based. And some of the components recommended for these programs include the following. That is prospective audit and feedback antimicrobial prescriptions to clinicians, formulary restriction, education, use of clinical order sets and guidelines, de-escalation of therapy, intravenous to oral antimicrobial, conversion when appropriate. Clinicians should make a priority to become aware of such programs in their institution. Preventing the emergence of antibiotic resistance. The widespread and often inappropriate use of antimicrobial agents is the single most important cause of emergence of drug resistance. Prior antibiotic exposure is the most frequent risk factor for the development of community-acquired respiratory infections caused by drug-resistant Streptococcus pneumoniae. Upper respiratory tract infection accounts for the highest proportion of ambulatory antibiotic prescriptions, and even in situations where antibiotics are not indicated. The emergence of antimicrobial resistance can be prevented or delayed through judicious prescribing, which can be characterized as follows. Avoidance of antibiotic treatment for community-acquired, mostly viral URTI, use of narrow-spectrum antibiotics when possible, use of narrow-spectrum antibiotics for the shortest duration. Okay. So, we are concluding, from the conclusion, the appropriate use of antimicrobial agents involves obtaining an accurate diagnosis, determining the need for and timing of antimicrobial therapy, understanding how dosing affects the antimicrobial activities of different agents, tailoring treatment to host characteristics using the narrow spectrum and the shortest duration of therapy, switching to oral agents as soon as possible. Non-antimicrobial interventions such as abscess drainage are equally or more important in some cases and should be pursued diligently in comprehensive infectious disease management. Thank you.